All right, everybody.
Mo went away somehow. Mo, I need to find you. We got the wrong speaker. Mo, I'm adding you as a speaker. And we're listening to the clash. All right. London and calling through the faraway town. What's going on, Laura?
I'm back.
And we're back. Let everybody funnel in. Come out of the cupboard, you boys and girls. London calling, now don't look to us. Phony Beatlemania is putting the dust. Right. London calling, see we ain't got no session, nice. Except for the rain and the crunch of pain. The ice is coming, the sun's zooming in. Meltdown expected, the wheat is good. I love that, Aleem. Engine's stuck on him. What's going on, everybody? All right, everybody, welcome back. Welcome back, Mo. I love this comment from Aleem. So doing stakeholder interviews on a consulting engagement, Mo, how many would you kind of do in a row? I know the answer is it depends, but can you give our learners an idea of how fast these interviews may happen in a week?
I mean, depending on the complexity of the project, I mean, you could have multiple stakeholder interviews through the week. So you could potentially be having two or three a day. Or in some cases, what happens is we actually sort of would do it in a sort of workshop environment. So you have multiple stakeholders and you sort of come together and you'd have a number of VAs and do this as a group exercise. So it really depends on the complexity. I've seen it work both ways. I recall on a project a few years back, you know, we had multiple workshops going on in a massive room, you know, people breaking out. So it can become quite overwhelming because you're sort of shifting from one stakeholder to the next within the same day and trying to absorb the information at the same time. So it depends again.
Yep. Of course it depends. I do remember for our learners, one of my engagements, one of the craziest ones in a week, we had about 20 stakeholder interviews, which meant, we were doing 3 to 4 a day for an entire week.
Yeah, it was quite easily. Yeah.
Yep, it was pretty intense. So we went through this yesterday, so you all know the agenda for this, but another repeat is, well, we'll give a couple of tips here in a little bit, but we'll really focus on the stakeholder interview. We'll take a break. We'll do a little bit of reflection from Mo. If anyone, again, does have questions about the process, go ahead and put them in the Q&A, but I imagine for the most part, everyone will be pretty good. Although, Rohan, can you actually put this question into the Q&A section? Because it's a really good one, and we'll put it at the end. Cool. So this is how this works. You interview Dmitry Ivanov, you get feedback, and we all learn together. So go ahead and raise those hands if they aren't raised already. We've got Vandana, Aleem, Surupa, Tina, Swadini, Juanita, Vandana, Ashuta. So keep them coming. And then same as yesterday, you guys got 50 minutes to get as many questions in here as possible. If some pop up in your head, just jump right back into the queue because we'll try to take up all 50 minutes if we can. Cool. So Mo, I'll pass it off to you. They all went through this with Azelle, but any tips that you might have before they jump into this interview with you?
Probably not a lot to add to what we said when we did the kickoff on Wednesday, yeah. And probably what Azelle has already shared with you. But I think the golden rule is, you know, keep the questions simple. Don't ask several questions at once. Listen carefully to avoid repetition of the same question in a different way further down the line. So again, make really good use of the time by exploring a lot of different areas and getting a good view of what the overall problems and challenges are for this for Dmitry when it comes to Black Friday and supporting customers. So again, listen, be prepared to alter your script or your questions from your bank of questions that you've already prepared as a team. Strike off ones that have already been covered. So you're focusing on the right things then.
Awesome. All righty. With that, Mo, are you ready to go through your transformation as Mo Jassett, Senior Director of Cognizant, to Dmitry Ivanov, Digital Sales Support Lead at Target? Yeah. All right. So I will go ahead and let's begin our stakeholder interview. Who is first up? We have Vandana, Aleem, Surupa are the first three. So I'll go ahead and bring up Vandana. We'll kick us off. I will manage the queue. I go hiding. I'm not part of the stakeholder interview, but hello, Aleem and everybody else. Oh, did I bring up Aleem first? Sorry, I thought I was Vandana first. But Aleem, you go ahead and kick us off, and then Vandana, you'll be second. And I will share the list here in a second. But you are ready when you are.
Sure. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can. Yeah.
Hi, Dimitri. Nice to meet you. We had a great chat with Nora, your colleague, and we're hoping to sort of take things forward from there. And we're hoping to learn from you what your idea and your vision of a successful post-sale support looks like. And that's going to be the vision going forward. So we're just trying to understand, since it's the first question, we're trying to understand what is your current post-sale support processes and what kind of data do you need to be able to effectively do those processes?
Yeah, so currently we have around 50 agents that provide post-sale support. So these are customers that have bought products from us through our website, through our digital channels, either mobile or through a desktop, laptop, etc. And typically what we have is, when it comes to sort of Black Friday, the volumes potentially triple in terms of the number of inquiries that we have following the Black Sale, the Black Friday sales. So over that sort of course of the week or so after that event, we get a lot of, obviously you can imagine, a lot of people have purchased products. They have queries that come through that our agents currently answer either by phone. So we have on our website a customer service number. We also have the ability to send inquiries via a contact form, which is on the website as well, or an email address, a customer service email address. So typically those are the channels that we use for customers to communicate with us. At the moment, we don't have anything around chat, which is missing. And really, you know, what I'm up against is that during that sort of Black Friday period, we actually increased the number of agents from 50 to typically around 100 agents. So we actually get people from other parts of the business to come in and help support the operation in terms of these inquiries coming through. Ideally, what we would like to do is not do that and be able to use our existing agents with a small increment of staff to be able to actually do more, right? So typically at the moment, we, you know, on a normal sort of day, our agents handle somewhere between sort of 10 or so inquiries per hour. If those agents during the sort of Black Friday week can improve that from 10 to 12 inquiries a week, inquiries per hour, should I say, that would have a significant effect on my staffing and the ability for me to sort of, you know, do more with less and provide a better customer experience. So I'm trying to actually improve the amount of queries that we can resolve during that week, that busy week, through, for example, the ability to be able to do direct chat, which means our agents can actually do multiple, they can serve multiple customers at the same time and actually resolve things a lot quicker first time around.
Makes sense. So as I understand it, you're trying to increase the work capacity of your existing agents to be able to equip them to resolve a more number of inquiries given the same amount of time and workforce capacity, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So there's two things. We want to be able to do more. So in terms of the number of inquiries handled per hour, we need to improve that by 20-30%. But also the first resolution time, which is quite important from a customer service perspective. So at the moment, we try and resolve around 60% of inquiries first time. So we're able to provide an answer to the customer when they make that first contact by email, by phone, etc. Or direct them to the right place on the website. We want to improve that to about 70%. So again, by enabling something like a chat function, it allows us to be able to very, very cleverly be able to answer the question there and then by providing the right link, for example, to our product support, the right link to our returns page, the right link to be able to find out what, you know, where their order is, for example. So, you know, 3 days on, their order hasn't arrived. We can divert them to the right place to be able to actually find out where their order is with the courier. So at the moment, our agents, for example, have two or three windows open at the same time to be able to resolve queries. So if you imagine as a customer, you've placed an order on Black Friday, following Wednesday, you know, you were expecting your order, it hasn't arrived. What you want to know is, where is that order? Now, yes, most people can track that through the courier website, but a lot of people just don't believe that information and want reassurance from us to make sure that order has been dispatched on its way. So our agent will typically open up the courier's website and do the inquiry for that order, and then basically play that back to the customer, say, this is where your order is. Our agents have more visibility into where the order is than potentially a customer has, because we have more details from the courier company themselves. But ideally, you know, if that information can be integrated into Salesforce, we can simply just send that out. We just copy and paste or press a button and it's to the customer. They're happy to know that the order is on its way. It's, you know, in depot number X, on its way to their address, and everyone's happy, right? So we get a lot of these repetitive inquiries that come through, and my objective with this project is to try and eliminate as many of those as we can through self-service, so the customer can find the information themselves, or we'd be able to get that information out very quickly through a chat window or automated chat. Again, you know, pretty excited about the AI stuff that's going on, whether we can try and build some of the AI where the chat can actually pick up through natural language the query and divert the customer or provide the answer. That makes sense.
Yeah. That makes awesome. Sense. Thank you so
awesome.
Much.
Good. So good much. Job, Aline. All right, let's go ahead and pass it off to Vandana P. Vandana, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Aline. Hello, Dimitri. How are you doing?
Yeah, good. Thank you, Vandana. How are you?
I'm doing well. I'm from Team 17. And my question would be, can you provide me an overview of your role within the organization? And what are your primary responsibilities and day-to-day tasks?
That's a good question, actually. Yeah. So my role is digital sales support lead. And essentially what I do is I manage a team of around 50 agents, typically, when things are running as normal, when we don't have the peak periods. And my team of agents provide support for all purchases made through our digital channels. So that's all sort of after sales support. So if you've got a query with your order, you want to, you know, call.
Yeah.
Et cetera, et cetera. So yeah, sort of fitting team inquiries to help people post purchase with their order. Or okay. Items. And my agents provide that service, so it's all around customer service.
Sounds good. And what are the key challenges or any obstacles you face?
I think I probably touched on one of those big ones, which is at the moment, the agents are looking at different systems, you know, to get the information. So one example I quoted you was the courier example. Yeah, trying to get information about where your order is. The second one is, you know, we've got a lot of product information, right? And people sometimes lose the manual. They don't know how to put the bike together, for example. Blah blah blah. So you know, we tend to sort of get those PDFs of documents and manuals and get them sent out. So again, you know, those are fairly common queries where people don't know or can't find the instructions, et cetera, and they'll ring us up saying, I'm missing the instructions, I've lost my instructions, how do I do X, Y, and Z? So we then try and sort of resolve that through providing the right information, whether that's an instruction guide, PDF guide, or a link to the manufacturer's website.
Thank you.
Awesome. Great job, Vandana. And Sarupa, we'll bring you up. Sorry, I forgot to bring you up. So great job, Vandana. Sarupa, floor is yours. And then we have Tina, Swadini, and Juanita.
Hi, Dimitri. Hi, Jeff. Okay, I am from Team 13. And my question to you is, from what I understand, your team handles inquiries only, or is it any kind of cases too?
All right. Okay. Well, there are cases. So each inquiry comes through as a, you know, as a case. And that's what we measure. We measure our number of inquiries coming in per week, per day, the metrics that we measure our agents on is how many of those queries can they resolve first time round, how many queries can they answer per hour. So those are two key metrics, and then we also collect customer satisfaction score as well for each inquiry that we close. So again, they're measured again on how well they provided that service, after sales service. So three key measurements: number of queries they can handle per hour, customer service in terms of CSAT, customer service score, and then obviously the other one is around, you know, making sure that they can resolve things first time round. Yeah.
Okay, my second question would be, how is your team different from Nora's team in terms of process, right, and support?
So I don't know what Nora has told you, but Nora's sort of head of retail success. So her team is more about, you know, the around making sure that, you know, the products are there. You know, we've got all the pricing there, the websites are there, the deals are there. So very much making sure all the infrastructure is there in terms of making sure, you know, we're able to serve the right time and the right price. You know, so that's really her role. My role is about servicing the customer afterwards.
Okay. Thank you,
Jeff. Great job, Sarupa. All right, Tina, let's go ahead and pass it off to you.
All right. Well, thank you for meeting with us, Mo. I'm pretty sure that you are meeting with one of the biggest consultant teams I know of, 56 plus people. Okay. So you mentioned Salesforce earlier, and I know that Target overall is using the Salesforce platform. Is your team currently using this platform? And if not, what other system are you using right now?
No, they are. So we're doing some basic things, right? You know, like the cases do come in through those channels I spoke about. So we have email, we have telephone, and we have contact forms. So, you know, all of those are generated as cases coming through to our team. Those are then triaged, and we decide, you know, who picks up what. So there's a level of sort of assignment of those cases done within the team. What we haven't got at the moment in Salesforce, what we haven't got as far as, is being able to assign a case to somebody else in the organization. So, for example, there are going to be situations where a customer rings up or customer emails us, and it's a fairly in-depth inquiry, right? It might be to do with payments being declined or whatever, and something the agent can't answer. They have to go to our finance department to find out what's going on. So therefore, they have to pass the case on. So case assignment is one area which we don't have today, which I think would really help to improve our customer service and the length of time it takes to resolve the case. So at the moment, the case sits with the customer service agent. The customer service agent will ring the finance department, find out what's going on, right? Wait for the finance department to come back, and then at some point pick that case back up, right? So it's all pretty long-winded, right? As you can imagine, as a customer, for them to resolve that and pass it back, you know, that I think that would speed things up. So that's another area, again, I have some issues with and challenges with at the moment, which I think Salesforce should be able to resolve.
Yes, I'd love to dig into that a little bit. So you've talked about wanting to have case assignments, and it sounds like some escalation process in place. Do you have kind of teams within your team of 50 that you would want, you know, some dealing with this type of intake and some dealing with that? What does that structure look like right now?
Yeah, so something I've been thinking about, again, you know, as we start to use Salesforce and get mature with the product, I think it's a good call that to be able to do what I think they call it in the industry, skills-based assignment. So we have, you know, particular people in our team that are very good at solving payment queries, and there's other people that are very good at tracking down issues with deliveries, right? So I think over the next sort of 12-15 months, it's part of my strategy to look at how I can split the team out based on their competencies and skills, and then, like you say, assign cases based on what type of case it is, right, to get the right person to actually be an expert in that area and resolve that much quicker, rather than everybody doing everything. So yeah, I think it's a good shout, and it's something we'd be looking to do.
Awesome. Thank you.
Great job, Tina. All right, let's pass it off to Swadini.
Hi, I'm representing Team 19. I would like to know, what are all the challenges that you're facing in terms of billing requests?
When you say billing requests, just expand on that, because we don't do any billing. We consumers typically turn up on our website, look at our products, and purchase our products through usual means, credit card, debit card, etc.
Yeah, from yesterday's interview, we have got a stakeholder mentioning about there is double charges on the billing. So if you are
Okay, all right, I understand now, all right. So double charges is where typically somebody's being charged twice for an item. They've either put the transaction through twice, something's happened on their side, or the bank or credit card company has charged that transaction twice. So yeah, we do get those queries coming through. Like I said, those are ones which we need to then pass on to our finance department to double check and verify there's been a double payment, and then for them to approve the refund.
Okay. On continuation with that, are you expecting any enhancements or tools specifically for handling the billing?
Not really. I mean, double payments are fairly common, right? So, I mean, if we can automate that somehow, that those double payment queries coming through can either be auto-routed to our finance guys to approve, and then it comes back to the agent to be able to issue the refund. That I think speed things up and make it more efficient. So yeah, I mean, I think it's back to the previous consultant that asked me the question around automation and assignment of cases. So if auto assignment can be something we can look at for those queries, I'd be more than happy.
Thank you so much.
Awesome. Great job, Swadini. Let's go ahead and pass it over to Juanita.
Hello.
Hello, Juanita.
Hello, I'm sorry. Just my computer was just a tad slow. Hi. Hello, Hi. Good to see you.
Hi. You too.
All right. Well, a lot of my questions have already been answered, so that's fantastic. I have another one that hope shed some light on an issue. How does a digital sales support team stay updated on product changes or updates to ensure that there's accurate information provided to customers post service or purchase, I should say?
Yeah, it's a good question, Juanita. I mean, our guys are pretty much reliant on our product teams to be able to make sure that we have the latest updates on products. And you can imagine, we sell thousands and thousands of products on our websites, right? And there are going to be occasions where, there might be things like the product recall, etc. And, we issue our customers with an email saying, hey, this product's been recalled by the manufacturer because it's not safe or whatever it may be. And then you can imagine the customers ringing up saying, what do I do next, right? How do I get my money back? So we're pretty much reliant on each of the product teams in our organization to provide those updates, and those are stored at the moment in a knowledge base that we have. Now that knowledge base, Juanita, sits outside of Salesforce today. All right. So it's just we've got a different solution that manages all of that content. So the guys have to go in, search for it, find the right information, copy paste, send it out. Yeah. If we could get that knowledge base somehow integrated into Salesforce, it would make life a lot easier, right? So we could do all the searching and everything within Salesforce. And at some point in the future, even automate some of that stuff where, based on keyword search and stuff, we narrow down what the product queries are, and then, really sort of give a very refined list of next steps or best sort of actions for the agent to follow up. So yeah. It's a good question. We do have lots and lots of information about lots of products. And at the moment, that is stored in a different system.
Okay. Wow. Thank you for that. This may be a little bit off topic. Hopefully it is not. I have actually worked in retail and I've always been curious. If someone buys something online, and I know Target, you can return, do a return in store. How does that affect you? If someone's, the original was online, now they're returning in store.
Yeah, it doesn't really affect us because, you know, the customer record is stored on Salesforce and essentially, you know, with that invoice number, it all leaks through. So I think regardless of the channel they use for return, whether it's a courier that they return through our system, through our agents, or whether they go direct to store, it doesn't really matter. It all ties it back up in terms of that return going through and being credited to the customer's account. So yeah, that works quite well. To be fair, Winnie, to that process works quite well. And yeah, you're right. A lot of our customers tend to order online, but then return things to the store because it's easier.
Yeah, all right. Thank you. You more than answered my questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Winnie. Great job, Juanita. Let's go ahead and pass it off to Vandana, and then we have Ashuta, Marina, and Janina on deck.
Yeah. Hi, Dimitri, and hi, Jeff. I'm Vandana. Hi, I'm Vandana from Team 14. I will go directly to my question. Are there any compliance or data security concerns or considerations that we need to be aware of when implementing any news for the Black Friday changes? Anything regarding data?
Yeah, so obviously, you know, because we hold personal customer data, like things like email addresses, full name address, etc. That all falls within, you know, the privacy of customer data. So, you know, we can't just assume anybody that's initiated a chat or a phone call is the customer that they say they claim to be. So we have to go through verification checks. So we normally would ask them for their postcode. We would ask them for their address, etc., to verify who they are before we engage with them. So there are some checks we do initially, and conscious that, you know, if we're going to introduce chat into the mix, that we would need to be able to verify that customer by them putting various details in, so we know it's that person that's talking to us, and it's not an imposter, if you like. So yes, data security is quite important to us to ensure that we are actually verifying the customer is genuine.
Great to know that. And my second question is, you said your team is already using Salesforce already, right?
Correct, yeah. So
in terms of user adoption, do you think you guys will need more training on that, or would the team be fine with any changes that might bring on, and if there is any integrations needed to the, I heard you said something about real-time data. So will you need any integrations for the real-time data and user adoption?
Yeah, so you know, like I said, at the moment, you know, we just to give you that example around the courier data, that is held in the courier system, right? So our guys have got access to that system. They have a separate window on their desktop that they open up and be able to then query that order number and get to a level of detail that's normally not available to the customer about where their order is. Now, if we could integrate that data into Salesforce so that people don't have to copy and paste into a separate window, it's there, we can track, you know, straight away, customer calls, I can see where their order is in that supply chain, you know, which depot it's in, how long it's going to take, what's the ETA, then that to me is a massive win for our agents and for the customer. So that's, if I was to prioritize, that's probably the one that I would prioritize as a major integration that we would like to have with the courier system. So what was the other question? Did you ask me two questions, right?
I mentioned the user adoption because your team is already using it. Yeah.
Okay. So user adoption. I mean, our agents, right? You can imagine in this sort of industry, we do get turnover of staff. And we also get a lot of temporary staff, right? So when we have Black Friday, when we have Christmas, we take on temporary staff, and we need to get them effective and operational very, very quickly. So to have something on the screen that guides them through the process, so you know they're not having to refer to a manual or ask their supervisor, what do I do next? To me, that's all sort of great stuff, right? So if we can build all of that into Salesforce, which helps them to guide them through the process, there's guided guided steps for our agents to follow to resolve a particular inquiry, then that's all good stuff that I would like to see.
Okay. Awesome. Great. Thank you.
Great job, Vandana. All right. All right, Ashuta, let's go ahead and pass it off to you.
Hello, Jeff.
Hi.
Hello. Hi, Dimitri. Thank you for sharing a lot of insights already, but I'm still a little curious to know if you could explain to us, if you can walk us through the typical workflow of a digital sales support agent from the moment the customer issues is raised.
So, there's different journeys, right? It would take me a long time to explain every single scenario, but very basic I can give you, right?
Sure.
The case comes in, like I explained before, different channels. Case is generated in Salesforce. Case is then picked up by one of my team. They either try and resolve that first time, depending on the nature of the case, whether it's a query about an order, where is my order? It's a query about a product. I need some help with my product. I need a warranty. I need a copy of my receipt. It could be a whole host of different things they need, right? So depending on what it is, we can either try and resolve that first time by the agent providing that information back to the customer through email, or it gets escalated and assigned out to another team, typically like the double charging we talked about earlier. That would have to be cleared by the finance team before we offer a refund. Not something my agents can do. We need to get that verified by finance to say, yeah, we've charged the customer twice, therefore we need to issue a refund. So I can't give you every single user journey, but what I would suggest you do is speak to one of our agents, one or two of our agents tomorrow, sit down with them, and they can take you through the most common scenarios. But like I said, those are probably the two or three that I've identified there that are common case scenarios. Does that help?
Awesome. Thank you very much. And another question would be, what key performance indicators are the most important for your digital sales support team, especially in this Friday time?
Yeah, I think I mentioned these in the previous answer to that. So it's around customer service, first time resolution, and number of queries per hour.
Okay, awesome. Three things. Thank you.
Great job, Ashuta. All right, Marina, floor is yours.
Okay, thank you so much. Hi, Dmitry. Hi, Jeff. I have also some questions. I have inspected the shop before. I have created my questions. What I have done, I have registered me as a user on the web page and play a bit with the web page, with the shop, to understand how it's what kind of feature you are having before the Black Friday, and how the from what kind perspective the service requests can come in from. My question is, Vandana has asked a lot about the chatbox. I have also tried the chatbot. As I was already assigned as a user on the web page, and chatbot still asked me to do some kind of verification. Why? Because I can show you the account I have created on the web page. Why the bot asked me about the verification if I am already assigned as a user on the web page?
Okay, so I guess this is to do with our security, IT security. So there's a double layer of verification that if you log in, that's fine. But if you then want to initiate a chat with our agents to talk about a specific order or a specific issue, then you have to go through a second layer of verification. It's probably the reason why you've got to verify the current chat, albeit that chat is in beta today, so it's something that we're just playing around with. So ignore that for the time being, and take the assumption from me that there is no chat today. We're not using it.
Okay. The second question is, as I have already registered on the web page or in the shop, I have tried some features, for example, gift. And there I have seen that, for example, under gift you, page, you have four areas. Baby, I think, then wedding, create the gift list and community. And I tried all these four areas and I was asked to log me again. Why I have done this to understand, yes, and I needed to log me there. Why it is not single sign on, and are these all four areas separated from the data perspective, from the data model in the it is replicating then on into the service request too.
Okay, so difficult for me to answer because I don't look after the actual web store itself. So the way it should work is you sign on if you already have an account and be able to navigate through the website without having to keep signing back in again. So if there's that problem, then there's clearly a bug somewhere. So let's pick that up separately over the next few days with our digital sales team and find out exactly what that scenario is. But clearly that's not within my remit. So I'm really focused on after sales service. The whole customer experience and stuff sits with somebody else, but let's look into that if that's a problem.
Okay, good. Thanks, Marina. We'll pass it off to Janina. Janina, floor is yours.
Hi, Dimitri. Thanks for meeting with us today. I'm Janina from Team 12, and I have one question about case assignment. You were saying that cases get generated in Salesforce and the agents pick them up. How specifically does that work?
They just simply pick them off one by one. There is no prioritization or any, like I say, no skills-based routing or anything like that. So literally they'll come in and they get tagged on in the order they come in, depending on who's available. And so there's not much science behind it at the moment.
Sounds good. That's what I needed to know there. And then also I was wondering if you could get into a little more detail in how escalations work right now. Is it just via email, or how do things escalate it to the next level?
Yeah, so there's sort of two levels of escalation. One is the agent escalating a case internally because they can't resolve it and they need someone else to step in to give them some sort of response. Then there's also escalations from customers who have not been happy with the service that we provide and they want to escalate to me, for example, right? So they're not happy with the response that's been given by our customer service agent. Now, in that case, what happens is the case is assigned to me by the agent, and then I will deal with that case in terms of contacting the customer, offering them discounts, offering them a gift voucher, whatever it may be, to help improve the experience. So, yeah, so there are escalations. That's very much down to the agent reassigning that case either to me or somebody else.
Okay. And do you have any timeframes for that right now? Like any set timeframes, or is that, it just depends on what the case is and how difficult it is?
Yeah. So escalations tend to get dealt with within sort of 24 hours of somebody getting an escalation coming through, whether that's me or someone else, some other manager in the team. So yeah, there is an SLA for escalations. In terms of the requests coming through from customers, we aim to get back to them within 48 hours with a response. Again, like I said, there isn't any level of prioritization around those cases. I think in the future it's something we could look at, you know, based on the type of query, whether if for example it's a double billing, right, that clearly takes priority over somebody wanting a copy of a receipt, which could wait for 3 or 4 days. Right? You don't need that urgently. Okay. Or you might do if you're trying to get a warranty claim done or whatever. But I think, you know, you can build some algorithms and intelligence behind that. But at the moment, we don't have that level of sophistication in terms of how we do it.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you so much.
Great job, Janina. All right, let's go ahead and pass it off to Chris.
Shoot. Oops. Oh, can you hear me? Sorry.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, we've got you.
Okay, caught me off guard. Anyways, going through our list of questions, a lot of them have already been answered. So, you know, I want to go with our final question, kind of, you know, nearing towards the end of this. Has there been anything that we've missed so far that you would like to address?
No, I don't think so. I think, you know, there's a lot here that we can still do with Salesforce, right? So we're really only scratching the surface in terms of using Service Cloud to manage cases. And I think there's a lot of automation that we've talked about today. What I'd like to see is a consulting team coming back to me to say what is possible over the next sort of 8 to 12 weeks. What can we do which is quick and gives me some business benefit? So I think I'm probably need a bit of help there, right? Because I don't know how long it's going to take. If I said to you as consultants today, go away and build some automation to do all of this fancy case assignment, you might come back and say that's going to take 4 months, right, to do all of this stuff. Versus, you know, I can improve your number of queries dealt per hour for each agent by 20%, and I can do that in 4 weeks. For me, that's going to be the 4 weeks get going. Let's do that first, right? So I think when you guys come back and present, it would be good to understand what level of effort, you know, some of the areas we talked about today take. So you'll help me to then work with you and prioritize what we do first and what we do last, if you like. That helps.
Okay. Yeah, that helps.
Awesome.
Thank you.
We'll go ahead and pass it off to Monica. Monica, floor is yours.
Yeah. Hi, Dimitri. Hi, Jeff. This is Monica here. I'm representing Team 5. And thank you for taking time to talk with us today. We did get answer to quite a few questions, but we do have one question about the data, like when normally the support case get logged via different channels, what are the details that we usually capture? And in future, do we want to capture any more details than what we have right now?
Yeah, so we capture sort of the basic details. So it's, you know, customer name, address, customer number, order number, if that's applicable, if it's an existing order that we're looking at. And then typically we have, I think, some categorization options there about what type of inquiry it is, whether it's a billing inquiry, whether it's product support, warranty support. I think it's about 9 or 10 options on the form. Mm-hmm. And then there's a free text box so people can just, you know, put in whatever they wish there in terms of their query to give us the context. So really that's sort of the base information we collect. Obviously, we then match up that the query we get comes from the email that's registered on our database by that customer. So we do verify that before we respond. Mm-hmm. So we know it's the right customer and it's not somebody that's trying to pretend to be someone else. That's the base information we capture today.
Okay. And continuing to that data question, you know, do we have any specific requirements for the sharing and visibility? Because see, Salesforce has a very great security structure. So we can have like some information visible to only specific set of agents and, you know, some information will be visible only to the managers. So do we have any specific data sharing and visibility requirements?
No, at the moment, because what I'd like is the flexibility for anybody to be able to handle a case, right? So if somebody's off on holiday, somebody's off sick, I don't want then for agent, if agent A is on sick, I don't want agent B to not have access to that customer record or that to that case. So I think I want to keep it relatively open in terms of data sharing within the team for all the cases.
Okay.
There is clearly sort of financial information as well that we hold on the customers. So like things like their credit score, their encrypted credit card details, etc. I mean, obviously all that information we don't want to be visible. But, you know, obviously there are some people like the finance department that would need that information to be able to process things. So again, yeah, I think we can work out who can see what when it comes to that sort of financial details, etc. But in general, okay. the case the details should be available to everybody in order to be able to help okay. the customer. Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay, got it. Thank you so much for the clarification.
Great questions, Monica. No problem, I'm going to pass it off to Rohan, and then we've got Aleem, Tina, and Dee to wrap up. Or just Aleem and Tina now. So Rohan, floor is yours. Rohan, are you there, Rohan? Rohan, are you there? Rohan, muted. Hold on, let me see. Oh, I can't unmute you. All right, Rohan, while we're figuring out your unmute situation, let's go ahead and bring up Aleem. Rohan, let's go figure it out.
Hi. Hi, Dimitri, once again. I hope we're not boring you with all the questions.
Very good questions.
Thank you. But just to continue where we left off. So as I understand it, in a case's life cycle, it comes from different channels and there are different types. And based on the nature of the case, it sort of hops on from one department to the other. So I see a lot of transition in the case's life cycle in terms of how it moves from one rep to the other in different departments. Like, how do you manage all this collaboration and communication? And is there anything that you would like improved if there is a pain point that exists currently?
Yeah, so I think, you know, if you take that sort of good example would be the finance example, you know, where we could do with assigning that entire case out to the finance department to be able to resolve things like the double payment queries. So I think it's about also looking at the scope of extending the Salesforce application out to other departments that can help to resolve the query. So at the moment, pretty much Salesforce is contained within the service department. So, you know, what we want to do is provide a view of the customer and the case to, for example, finance. It could be even to the product team. So like I said, the other ones we tend to get quite a lot of is product recall or product. There's issues with the product that we need to inform the customer about, and they may have questions about the product and, you know, the safety of the product, etc. So again, it's something the agent may not have the knowledge, or they may not be able to find the knowledge, and therefore we want to pass that case on to the product team to be able to answer the specific query. So assignment of those cases and visibility of those cases to other departments is quite important. Because at the moment it's slowing us down. We're having to do this sort of interaction and collaboration by email. I've heard about Slack as well. That's quite an interesting one, because even if we don't give them Salesforce, we could potentially give them something like Slack, right, to be able to collaborate on a case. So they've got everything there. You know, the case gets assigned to somebody. They use Slack to be able to respond back to the case, and that's all integrated then into Service Cloud. So, yeah, I'm open to some ideas there around how we can make collaboration better. And I did see an interesting session around Slack with Salesforce a few weeks ago. So yeah, would like to explore that a bit more.
That makes sense. We hear you, and we'll work on something to help you collaborate better. Just a second question, if there is space for it.
Yep.
Right. So we understand that Black Friday can be a difficult time for reps and for customers and for employees. So what systems that currently work tend to break down during Black Friday? And do you want to sort of maybe shed some light on what we should do to improve those specific aspects?
Yeah, I mean, Black Friday is a massive peak for us. And typically, it's got better over the years, but it tends to be, you know, the usual things. The website slows down, right, because everybody's trying to log on, trying to get a deal. We also have limited deals on Black Friday, so we've got X amount of stock. And once it's gone, right? So people are, like, really sort of getting on their keyboards and trying to get the deal, right? So we always have these peaks where either the website sort of goes down, etc., and then people start to either ring us or whatever, saying I can't get on and I can't seem to log on, and it's taking me 5 minutes, the things just spinning around on the screen. So we do still get that at various times, depending on, you know, what deals we have on Black Friday. So I guess it's something that impacts us directly, but it's not something that I can fix. It's down to the web team to optimize all of that and to be able to cope with the thousands of customers that log on to a single day. But there is an impact for us at the moment where we do get those calls. It'd be great to just say, be patient, or just try again, or come back in 20 minutes and keep logging in. I think the web team are putting in some sort of queuing mechanism on the website to sort of help to sort of stabilize the traffic. So, you know, we don't get an influx of people just trying to log on. We manage the number of logons over a period of time and have a queuing system. So it's getting better, but it does have an impact on us.
Awesome. Great questions, Aline.
Thank you so much.
All right, let's go ahead and pass it off to Rohan. Rohan, looks like you're back in action.
You guys can hear me? It's working now? Okay.
Yeah, we can, yeah.
James' first question and the follow-up. What did he ask? I want to make sure I don't repeat it.
I don't remember.
Well, when Aline first came on, I remember you mentioning functionality, and you don't really have that. Are you referring to chat collaboration tools, chatbot?
Sorry, say that. CSM? So what was the question?
So I was speaking with Aline and Vandana when they interviewed you, and you mentioned that you want to add chat functionality.
Yes.
You don't really have that right now.
Not really.
Chat
no.
collaboration, no. Or do you want to have like a chatbot to help with the CS solution? What would it specifically wanting with that?
Yeah, it's more sort of the chatbot. It's more about the interaction between the customer and our agent. So that's really the focus area. The bit about the other area I talked to Aleem about was internal collaboration.
Gotcha. Yeah. And addition further with that, be like fully self-sufficient in issue resolution stage, or are you looking for the chatbot to be able to go in systems so that your CSRs don't have to the data to get the information they want?
Bot, yeah, I think
handle that.
Ideally, with now Salesforce coming with Einstein 1 and all the AI intelligence, I think we all want to get to a place where it's first-time resolution just entirely through the chatbot. So the chatbot almost becomes your agent, you know, and you can talk in a natural language way with the chatbot to say, I'm having a problem with my order. Where is my order? Here's my order number. The chatbot then integrates with the courier system and pulls that detail through to the customer to give them a view of where their order is or where their return is, what's happening with their double charging, et cetera, et cetera. So yeah, ideally we want to get to that point. I realize it's a long journey. We may not be able to do everything tomorrow or the next 8 weeks, but if you guys can show me something in terms of a demonstration around how you can, you know, try and automate something around chatbots bringing in that information, that'll be great to see.
Our developers and see what the estimated time scope for that is.
Awesome.
Sorry, I think you're cutting out. Just repeat that again, Rohan.
I'll check with our developers, see what estimated time for completion would that be, and I'll.
Okay, awesome. Cool.
Something
yeah,
we can do.
That's great. Yeah.
All right. Great job, Rohan.
Thank you.
Let's go and pass it off to Tina to close this off.
All right, Tina again from Team 18.
Hello, Tina.
I forgot to mention that before. Hello. So I wanted to touch back on something you had mentioned regarding your agents and when they're needing to work with customers and provide documents, so forth. I'm curious where those documents or those articles are housed right now and kind of how that process looks.
Yeah, we have at the moment a standalone, what we call a content management system, which holds all the documentation. It's pretty good, actually. It's pretty good in terms of being able to search by product or various other filters to be able to get to that information, whether that's product instructions, warranty information, et cetera, et cetera. And then typically what happens then is that once the agent has located the right document, that document is then sort of extracted and, you know, it's attached to the email and then sent on to the customer. Ideally, if we can eliminate that content management system and bring it inside of Salesforce, right, to have some sort of knowledge base internally within Salesforce, I think it'll just make that thing a lot quicker, right? Because you just do all your searching within Salesforce, or even to a point with the automation and the AI stuff is, you know, proactively, right, Salesforce will say, actually, for this particular product that the customer's querying about, here are all the documentations, yeah, associated with that product. So you don't even have to do any searching, it's there, right? And you just say tick, 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 that's the one that the customer wants, off it goes through the chat, job done, right? Customer's happy. So I think, you know, we're always looking for, say, you know, the 2 or 3 seconds we save, you know, if you add that up with over 50 agents, over 500 queries per agent per week, it's a massive deal for us, right, in terms of time saving. And that means we can offer a better customer service, a quicker customer service, and improve everything. So I think, you know, don't underestimate even the small things that we can do to actually save 2 or 3 seconds. It has a significant impact when you multiply that across the number of hours and number of queries that we handle.
Yes, thank you for elaborating on that, because that feels like a pretty integral part in meeting what you've shared as your MVP.
Yeah.
And I'll end now. I think we're a little over time. Thank you so much for your time.
We are good.
Thanks, Tim.
Somebody else is keeping track. Awesome. Great job, everybody. Great job to Tina, everybody who came up on stage. Ooh, lots of fun stuff for me to talk about. I had my popcorn up. Mo, great job. Take a breather. Yeah. Now return to Mo land. How does it feel when you guys go into your alter egos? What is it like?
It's tough. I mean, I can, and it also gives you a sense of, you know, how the stakeholder feels. So it's actually quite an interesting position to be put in, right? Because we as consultants or BAs, you know, we always see one side of the story, never sort of empathize how it might feel for someone at the other end trying to give you all these answers. So it's quite an interesting one. And I guess the twist to it all is, I'm making this stuff up, right, to a degree,
yes,
from my past experience. Guys, I saw some comments coming through about some of this sort of overlaps with what Nora had probably said to you. So that's fine. You know, don't worry about any of that overlap and, you know, that sort of overlap of roles and stuff. I think just take away all that information that Izelle has given you, I've given you, and then it doesn't matter if there's duplication. The idea is, guys, you need to go and build something that really offers that value to the client, whoever it is, whether it's Nora or me, Dimitri or whatever, to say, hey, this is going to save you time and this is going to really deliver some business benefits. Because the whole point, it always comes back to your role as a business analyst. How are you going to deliver value? Yeah, it's not just about creating functionality, but is it really going to benefit anybody at the end of the day? So always have that in the back of your mind.
Yep, 100%. And I think, Mo, we'll get to kind of initial feedback from you just in terms of questions. I think there'll be like two topics that I definitely want to chat about. But just in general, how'd you feel the learners did? I guess we can start with that and then a couple of follow-ons.
Yeah, I guess, Jeff, you know, if we compare this to some other sort of stakeholder interviews, standalone ones we've done, I mean, the quality of questioning has been incredible, right, as we know. And I think it's because, you know, this is a question. The learners are at a different level. So I got to really applaud whoever's come on stage, and there's a good few of you that came on today with some excellent questions. Very open questions. Allowed me to sort of talk. I think there was a lot of listening that was going on in the background, I assume. You didn't interrupt me at times, so that was great to hear that you allowed me to just express what I needed to express. I think there were a couple of examples that we went through where there was two questions being asked at once, and I basically went back and said, did you ask me two questions? What was the first question you asked me? Deliberately, because I knew that you know, it's just to bring out the learning around keep it to one question at a time. It just helps helps their stakeholder. And I think there was also an instance that we had where try not to have a lot of preamble before a question, because it sort of loses the momentum of what you're trying to ask. So just dive in and ask the question, and then, you know, if you need to then probe that answer a bit more than probe. But try not to have a lot of, take 2 or 3 minutes to sort of set a scene or whatever, you know, because the whole point of this time, this really valuable time you have with a stakeholder, is to try and extract information, not give information. Mm-hmm. Awesome. So yeah, that's some of the learning that I think and feedback I can give from the session today.
Yeah, awesome. And Elaine, great job right off the bat with the active listening. It's like you went through like our active listening skills challenges. Clients want to be heard, right, Mo? Like, it's a big piece. Like, they want to hear that you hear their problems first and foremost. So repeating back, right, can be like a really good way to validate. Plus, you added on more information after that one, right? Good tactic to just kind of like practice.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there's some really good open questions that came out, right, about, is there anything else that you think is going to help? What are you doing today? You know, what are the challenges? What are the metrics? What are you being measured on? So these were all good questions, right? Because it ultimately boils down to, you know, Dimitri has some KPIs that he's measured against, and he clearly wants to improve all of those. So how are you guys going to help with that? So yeah, some really great questions, you know, that were asked, and I think there's hopefully loads of information there. But I think now the challenge is, what do you do with that information? How do you sort of assimilate that information, prioritize, you know, what you can deliver quickly? Because there's loads you could do here, right, in terms of automation and everything we talked about. But the problem is, you've got 8 weeks, probably got 2 or 3 sprints. So how are you going to figure out what's going to be the best thing to recommend back to Dimitri and Nora?
Mm-hmm. Awesome. So I loved this particular interview for a very big reason. Mo, you are a consultant and you drive solutions. What happened when your client is building the solutions for you, and how do you redirect a client like that who's just like, this is what you guys are going to do, or trying to direct it, or already has something in their mind in terms of how it should work? How do you kind of navigate that?
Yeah, that you do get people that are, you know, clients that are very prescriptive and they already know what they want. And you know, it's a difficult one to try and crack. All you can do as a business analyst is you know, be proactive and show them the art of the possible. And often what happens with stakeholders, particularly stakeholders that have been there in that role for a long time, they are sort of boxed into just one way of thinking. They don't know what the wider industry does, right, and what are other companies in their field of industry are doing, what are their competitors doing. And I think sometimes, you know, you coming in as an impartial consultant that have worked on other projects, you can bring some of that learning from those projects to that stakeholder, say, actually, you know what, there are other clients that are doing this and they've got this benefit from it. You should really consider it because you're missing out. And a lot of stakeholders, if they realize a competitor of theirs is doing something different, they want to listen, right? So I think, yeah, it's bringing your external experience as well to be able to crack that particular challenge where people have got a very narrow and focused idea of what they want. And sometimes it is what it is. You can't change that, and you've just got to deliver that. Yeah. But be very clear, that's the scope then. You know, that's what you want, that's what you'll get.
Yep, awesome. Always fun. And then sometimes it's not what they want, and then you just get to charge more money, right?
Yeah, exactly. Which kind of leads to the next. It actually works to your benefit, yeah.
Yeah, we screwed up. We built what you wanted, and now it sucks. Yeah. Now we're going to charge you more money, which goes to scope. Right. So scope, like, how do you, during these interviews, like, how would you, I mean, like, there's a lot of different ways you could do it, but how would you kind of like recommend, if they were coming in their day one doing interviews, that they think about scope in terms of what it is that you're supposed to deliver?
Yeah. So scoping is a bit like a funnel, right? Because when you have that first stakeholder interview, what you don't want to do is start to scope it, because you then basically don't listen. You try and have a perceived view of what you think the client wants, and therefore it just you just don't get the full view. So I think you've got to allow the stakeholder to really go out and let them tell you everything they want to tell you, right? Including aspirations that may not be possible today, but it might be something further in the roadmap that you've captured, right? And you build that out. So if you're working for a consulting firm, it's not about just delivering a project, it's how do you get your next piece of work? How do you keep building this system for the client? So you've got, you know, you've got a role in that organization for a long period of time, and you're actually delivering constant value out of Salesforce as a platform. So you start very, very broad, right? At the funnel, the top of the funnel, everything, tell me everything. And then you naturally, as you come through the user stories and you go through prioritization, and these are all the sessions we're going to be going through over the coming weeks, is that's when you start to really define the scope and get it down to a point where you agree, okay, next 8 weeks, this is what we're delivering, and this is what's possible. Now, all the other stuff is fine. You can still have that on the backlog, right? And that backlog might take a year, might take 2 years to deliver, but don't lose sight of it, because all of that stuff from that first conversation helps to develop that backlog of work for the future. So start very broad, and the scoping then comes through consecutively over a period of time as you define the user stories and prioritize those.
Awesome. Cool. Great. So I want to pop up this question from Maria, because three people bumped it up. So how was the work, and Mo, this actually isn't a question for you, but we can go through it. How was the work from Dimitri and Nora's team different? And Mo kind of already alluded this to everyone. They both have to make this up a little bit. So they may be touching on the cases. Listen to the pain points of what their roles are, right? Like, this is actually a big reason why, like, whenever somebody comes in and be like, what do you do? They could be touching the same cases, but at different points. In the end, make up a narrative that makes sense for you all, right? Like, I would actually pose this back to everyone, post this in the Slack, start to describe how you are all seeing the roles overlap and not overlap. Because, like, Mo, this actually might be a piece that actually could happen in an engagement project, right? Trying to figure out, like, where do these roles overlap? Like, this is actually confusing. I don't understand. Have you had, like, an example or anything like that that maybe you could think of how this might have happened in a potential engagement, even knowing this is, like, a totally made up scenario? So
yeah, I mean, you know, they're inevitably going to be overlaps between roles and departments within in a large organization. And if you talk of a global organization, a specific role in one country may be referred to as something very different in another country. And if you're doing a global implementation of Salesforce, you've got to figure that out, right? Because, you know, somebody will call themselves as a sales success manager, they're actually handling cases. Someone in Greece might call themselves, you know, I'm a digital service agent or digital service lead. They're actually handling cases, but they call something else. So it's not uncommon in a very large organization where, if you're dealing with it at an enterprise level across markets, that you have people that have got different titles, but essentially are touching the same things and ultimately trying to drive the same outcomes. So yeah, it's not something that I'm surprised that happened here, where Nora is sort of touching cases and I'm touching cases, and there might be some overlap, right? And that's fairly natural to have. I think ultimately, as long as you deliver for each of those stakeholders, and it could be one solution you build that satisfies the requirements of both stakeholders, it's cool. Yeah, you've done it. So don't get involved too much in the politics of who does what. Ultimately, what you're trying to do is drive the value, the business outcome and the value. And that value could apply to a whole host of different people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're going to have to do one of the angry stakeholder, politic-driven stakeholder interviews in these courses as well, because politics is...
We should do. Yeah, politics is really bad.
Yeah, it's everyone just get ready. We don't practice it. It's coming. So, yeah. So here's a good question from Aleem. If they're already using Salesforce, like, you know, Mo and your alter ego, Dimitri, pretty familiar with Salesforce or some of the functions or had some ideas, when is it okay to discuss solutions? And maybe this early on, what options are available? Like, how is this gray area, or is it just black? Don't talk about solutions.
I think, you know, this stage of this interview, I think it's too early to talk about solutions. I think it's more being an active listener and understanding what the challenges are, and not jumping to, we'll put Slack in, that'll solve all your problems. May not do, right? I mean, yes, stakeholder mentioned Slack, but, you know, is it the right thing? Is it a good fit? And those are things that you need to sort of really consider and design and plan with a technical architect there being with you, the developers being there with you, the product owner. So some of these discussions you'll take away and deep dive into before getting to a solution set. So yeah, ultimately, you know, the company has invested in Salesforce. They see that as a strategic platform for customer service. They're not going to bring something else in, right? They want to expand the use of that platform. So all solutions will ultimately be within Salesforce, whether that's Slack or whatever it may be, Tableau, whatever. But don't get into getting the solution on the table at this stage. It's too early. And it may be the wrong thing once you start to deep dive into it. So yeah, it's hard to do. It's hard to resist. Because when somebody mentions Slack, you suddenly jump onto it, think, yeah, that'd be a good fit. But is it? Mm-hmm. And are they ready for it? So it's something that I would sort of hold back on until you've had that real clarity around scope and discussions, and you've had the chance to also talk to, you know, a solution architect. Because if it's a complicated project you're working on, you will have a technical architect there as well that's interested in the overall design of the architecture, and is it future proof? Are we creating technical debt here by doing this and this? So again, as a BA, you don't have that technical ability, I guess, to be able to make those decisions. So you might be lining up a solution which the technical architect might think, why did you tell them that? Because that's not the right way to do it.
Yeah, awesome. So Rohan's got a couple of fun ones here to close off the session. I'll go back into the chat as well. Let me see if I missed any. There might be a few, but we'll go to this question first. So Mo, just from your experience, what's the minimum number of stakeholders you've done, and what's the max that you would guess?
Well, the max would be a global rollout where you could be easily doing, you know, up to 50 plus interviews. If you include the whole scope of users, so that's everybody from a manager to a leader to the end user. So you end up interviewing quite a lot of people within the organization to get a view to a small project, which could be 20, 30 people, right, that are going to use Salesforce in an organization, in which case it could be, you know, two or three different stakeholders that you deal with. So there's a spectrum, right? And it depends on the complexity of the project, the size of the project, the scope of the project, to how many interviews you do.
Yeah, awesome.
So I can't give you a fixed figure for that.
Yeah, and then where was the other one? So I think there was I guess just in terms of scope, Mo, do you want to just kind of describe how this might work? Because Aline's asking, so does the PM make sure it's scoped items? How does scope actually work when you're on an engagement? If something's like feeling like it's creeping, how do you kind of manage that?
So yeah, you're right. So the product owner, product manager, is essentially the person from within the client side that is managing that scope. And a good project, a good scrum master, a good consultancy will always work hand in hand with the product owner from the client side to be able to agree the scope, you know, and get that signed off saying that's what we're delivering. And sometimes, you know, projects are never easy. Sometimes you underestimate a user story, right? So it's actually turned out to be more complicated than what we thought because something has come out of the woodwork that wasn't identified. And I think then you have that discussion with the product owner saying, actually, you know what, this is now not, you know, something that's going to take us 5 hours, it's going to take us 10 hours. Therefore, we need to drop something, you know, from the sprint to be able to deliver this, or we substitute it and put this on the backlog again and reprioritize. So, you know, in an agile sort of delivery, scope is, I think, easier to manage because you can have those trade-offs with the product owner about what goes in and out. And you always have a backlog, right, that is a list of moving things which you keep reprioritizing. So, yeah, if, you know, Salesforce is typically delivered in an agile way, and it's about managing that scope with a product owner. Not always an easy journey because sometimes you get it wrong, but it's then being adults about it and sitting down and saying, actually, you know what, I don't think this is estimated correctly, so let's review.
Awesome. Cool. And then the last fun one, Mo, how do you prepare yourself for your transformation into somebody like Dimitri? What is the mental prep?
Well, so I think quite a few of you went onto the Target website. So I did that earlier today to get a feel for, you know, what am I up against here and what have they got today. So I think, yeah, it's about preparation. I mean, I sort of made some notes about, I don't know, I'll put it up. So there's my one page of notes about my
paper. Hey, that's pretty great.
So I do some preparation. I don't make it all up. So I sort of went through and said, you know, what are my big challenges that I'm going to articulate to these guys over the hours. So yeah, I made, you know, the three things I talked about. I want to try and close things first time. I want to try and improve the number of inquiries per hour and the CSAT. So yeah, there is some level of preparation that goes on behind the scenes.
Awesome, I love that. And no, for our learners, most of our coaches are the same as well, which is why when we get to the stage, thank you, Mo. I think everybody is seeing behind the scenes, our coaches have very busy day jobs. They take some time out to write some notes about their fake person so that we can all learn during these experiences. Thank you, thank you, thank you a ton, Mo. And we are 100% off and running, everyone. And now it is user stories time. So we'll see you all next week. You guys have a weekend and 3 days or 2 days. Still pretty cool. But we'll see you all next week for some user stories. Thanks again, Mo. This was a great session.
Thanks, everybody. Appreciate it. Great session, everyone. Thanks very much.
All right. Have a great weekend, all. Bye-bye. See you next week. Bye. Bye.